So today, at the end of class, I'll bring up the final project groups, which I've laid out, and we'll just spend a little time breaking them into the groups and talking about the overall final project. Right before that, I'll talk a little bit about Gemini, partly to go through some images. The assignment and the reading from my book was almost exclusively focused on the guidance and control stuff. We'll talk a little bit about other aspects of the program. But we're also very privileged today to have TJ Creamer with us, NASA astronaut, who you've all seen has given a talk, what, at 4 o'clock?
4:30. 56114.
Okay, that doesn't immediately ring a bell where that
yeah,
is.
Next to 60.
Okay. I've been on leave for a year and a half. Like, my MIT room numbers are a little rusty. And he's speaking about the U.S. and Russian programs in his talk. But Larry invited him, and he kindly agreed to come share some thoughts and I'm sure answer some questions about particularly U.S.-Russian relations in the current day. And it's very different from in the Apollo era, but has that kind of background in the Apollo era. So,
please.
And Larry.
TJ had the privilege and experience of spending half a year on the International Space Station, was launched on the Soyuz, so he knows what the Russian manned spaceflight program as of this period is, and we're interested in how what he has learned relates to some of the things we've been talking about the differences in the Russian approaches going back to Sputnik.
Thanks, Michael. I appreciate it.
Welcome to you.
And before I get any farther, is the sound check good? Okay, super. Hi, guys. Thanks for letting me to come and share with you a couple of things. I won't detract from the course for very long. I will tease you with the 4:30 talk. The 4:30 talk will be about an hour long or so, and I talk a little bit about where we've come from, where we are currently, and where we're going. And of course, the where we're going part becomes a very joint impetus among many governments. The commercial entities are going to come behind us and fill in the low Earth orbit servicing, and then the governments together will go farther to other destinations. So come on, let me tell you a story. Everyone loves a good story. Now, speaking of my time in Russia, I got selected in 98, went through the normal basic baby astronaut training, grew up to be a teenager astronaut, and advanced training and stuff, but through that time frame, I've been working with the Russians in a supporting engineer role, and basically the computer network on board is mine, my design. It was horrible, I admit it. January of 2000, the governing body that's bilateral at the time, US-Russian, said we need a unified network. The Russians had a tiny one, the US had a tiny one, go make it up and down. And I said, sure, we'll do that. How much money are you gonna give me? None, and you gotta have it done in 6 months before the first crew gets up there. Silly people. So we had to use space qualified material already. And so really, it's really not a good computer network design, and it grew up, but it lasted from 2000 to 2007 before we had a major upgrade. Through this exposure of working with the Russian engineers, mostly Energia, who's building all the rockets, I got good friendships and interesting exposures to their philosophy. And then as I got into the advanced training for my Soyuz mission and the space station training that they provided also, a couple things jumped out at us that I had never been really aware of before. When we have a problem commanding, we find an alternate command path. Go close that valve. Well, that command didn't work. We'll go around another way via another network and we'll try to command and close the valve again. The Russians, if that first valve doesn't close, they move physically over to the other valve and close that one. Lots of their stuff is internal. Lots of their stuff is very rugged. Lots of their stuff is very basic, but by golly, when you put a human in the loop and you move to the alternate position and use the alternate device, it is very robust. We flew up in a Soyuz. Imagine three guys who wear extra large shirts sitting in your bathtub with their legs draped over the side. That's kind of what Soyuz is like. We were in there about 3 hours before launch in the semi-fetal position where your ankles are up under your butt and you're kind of roped in there, not in a real comfortable. An hour into that, I was ready to tell national secrets. But regardless, many people said, but it's the Russian system. Do you feel have any concerns? And the bottom line is, there's backup system for the backup systems, and then you get the manual systems. It is an extremely rugged little Volkswagen kind of device. With this philosophy that's grown up through their space station program, back to Mir, and before that even, we're even similarly using the same kind of capsule, basic design that Gagarin was using with some twists. But that same kind of philosophy has served them well. The engineer who designed the space potty on the Mir is still the engineer of the space potty on the space station. Their longevity is based upon their lifespan. Slightly different. But with that kind of engineering pedigree, when we start talking about going farther and farther than low Earth orbit, the U.S. is listening and negotiating on how to do this with them. Because one thing, if you haven't come across yet already, when we made the decision to go to the moon, there was a talk about whether to go do a space station or go farther, and a comment at the time by James Webb, I think it was, that said, one thing that the Russians do very well is heavy lift. We can't beat them at heavy lift. So that's why we went to hopscotch to go, one of the reasons why we went to hopscotch to go to the moon. There are other military and political reasons there, but the technical reason. So as we're going farther and farther, to be at an asteroid or moon or one of the Lagrangian points or Mars, we're relying upon them to help provide a lot of things. So let me leave that as a teaser for my talk later today. And since you look very comfortable, I'll say any real quick questions while I have the floor while I have you? Okay.
Thanks, TJ.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Bill.
Put the room number up here with those tables again.
Okay. I want to talk a little bit about Gemini. We'll see how far we get. There's a lot to say about it. A lot of people feel it's kind of underappreciated in the history of U.S. human spaceflight. It doesn't have the kind of John Glenn heroism that the early Mercury flights did. Obviously, it doesn't have the moon. But the linkage between the two was really critical. And even just in preparing the slides for today, you know, Mercury was a toe in the water, really. Like, we sent people up there. They didn't die. That was good. You know, they maybe spun around a little bit. We learned a bit, but far from being an ordinary activity. And Gemini really starts at that point and goes to the point where you really got to be comfortable in space. You got to be there for a long time. You got to do some pretty advanced maneuvering. You got to deal with failures. You got to deal with team dynamics. You got to deal with multiple vehicles, multiple launches, on down the list. All things that are built into Apollo, but you know, most of the history we've talked about so far, including the LOR, is all before a single Gemini flies, right? So before any of this program gets started, NASA has already committed itself to, well, a single launch, but multiple launches in the course of a year, and a single vehicle with two human qualified vehicles in it, rendezvous, all these different pieces, not to mention the failure contingencies. So a lot of that Gemini gets you from here to there. Was originally thought of as kind of Mercury Mark II, late 61, again, introduced after the Apollo decision, rechristened Gemini in 1962. Here's a key piece of it is endurance, right? Again, the Mercury flights were hours. If you want to get to the moon and back, you got to be up there for 2 weeks. What are those effects on the human body? How do you deal with the issues around consumables? How do you just deal with the basic mission management issues? Second key point, we talked about this the other time, rendezvous and docking. How do you do that? What is involved? What are the contingency issues? EVA, first time there. Another sort of basic component. Pinpoint reentry and landing, pretty important. for Apollo for a variety of reasons, and much more focused than Mercury, and just generally build up experience. I think one of the really interesting things about Apollo, and it certainly applies to Gemini, we'll see this when we look at the individual flights, is just the degree of learning that takes place. You could take this whole course and this whole study and just say, this is a study in technological learning. I certainly didn't appreciate this when I started working on the book, that the, you know, the final Apollo missions were so much more sophisticated and rich and deep than the first ones. You know, Apollo 11 was a few hours on the moon, go home. Apollo 17, I think it was Jack Schmidt who came here and said this, and that really brought it with me. He's like, you know, we talk about living in space. I lived on the moon for 3 days. And I went to work every day. I came home and I went to sleep, and you know, we've done it. And very different from just a couple years earlier, Apollo 11, kind of shaky, getting out, again, putting your toe in. But the missions are all sort of designed to have that level of learning. One thing I paid a lot of attention to writing the book is, like, what were the changes they made between the missions, right? And we'll see some of that here. So this general experience issue, how do you build up a program? How do you start something and then kind of work through it? And very difficult problem here because, as we're seeing, this project isn't even conceived until 61, 62. And that's the key year where the big design decisions are already being made on Apollo, not to mention all this little experience, not to mention Mercury. Mercury did better at the sort of lessons learned going into Apollo. Gemini, it was a real trick. So looking at the two spacecraft, they look similar or different to you? Similar? What's similar about them? Maybe an idea why?
New Mercury work.
Made by the same people. And both made by McDonnell Douglas. Again, interesting piece. Gee, these guys have made two really successful spacecrafts for us. Why don't we have them make the next one? Nope. Go to somebody completely different. Very bold decision. Why do you think that was done? Sorry?
Didn't they start Apollo around the same time?
Yeah, they felt McDonnell Douglas was busy, although there were a lot of other issues, and it was actually a bit of a scandal. There was a congressional investigation. I'm not remembering exactly. There was some deal concerning vending machines and the California lobby and North American. So that's where pretty good amount of learning going from Mercury to Gemini, more difficult going from Gemini to Apollo. Obviously one, two crew members. You also notice here this big nose. Lots of stuff in that nose. We'll look at it, not least of them the maneuvering system there. What else do you see that's common with Apollo that's different from Mercury?
Service module and crew module.
Good. So you have this configuration, which we'll see again. Service module, lots of the consumables back there. That's what enables your long duration with a spacecraft that, even though there's two people, it's pretty comparable in size. I bet if you looked at the volume per individual, it's pretty similar to Mercury. That becomes a familiar configuration. There's a kind of three-stage, actually, with the retrograde rockets here. This one's blown off before coming in. All the consumables back here. I am actually not all that familiar. Maybe somebody knows with in Apollo, I had always wondered this, and you really have to look carefully at the spacecraft, like, how does all that stuff get up there, right, or be controlled? Now, a lot of it doesn't have to, but a lot of it does. This is where the oxygen supply is and whatnot. And in Apollo, there's actually I forget the acronym for it. There's like a little clip that comes around the side, and I'll show that to you next time we look at it. I'm not sure how that worked in Gemini. You can't really have it go through the back. Why not? That's your heat shield, so there's got to be some way to get all the control signals down and a few of the consumables coming up. Another shot of that. This is what another one. You also have a sense, more so with Gemini than Mercury, that they're actually in a position to drive this thing. Yep.
On one of the earlier schematics, it listed ejection seats. Was that for abort launches?
Good question. We'll talk about that. Yeah, so this could be it here. That's what it looks like on the Apollo capsule, so it probably is similar there. And big difference from Mercury, the windows in the front. You know, so they're, other than when they're on the pad, you really have the sense of driving the thing forward for all of that kind of orbital rendezvous and docking. And this is something you really wanted to practice, flying this vehicle in the way that they did. Launched also on an ICBM, not on a custom rocket. The Gemini Titan is right here. Obviously, the Titan is still a vehicle that's with us. Talk about evolution. Just gives you a sense of the scale there. Liquid-fueled ICBM. This one's a little harder to see how it's arranged. I think there's another one. So really, there's some really good photography of this. I don't think it happened in my show here about the equipment. Joysticks in the middle, a board handle on the side. We'll talk a little bit about the computer that was in the reading as well. Again, windows facing forward, not sideways. Here's a photograph of it. Kind of fisheye lens. Still, I mean, I'm sure some of you have seen these in the Smithsonian, right? Hard to picture spending 2 weeks in there, I got to say.
Do you have a picture with crew members in it?
I think I do, yeah. Here's the instrument panel. Again, orientation sensor, very similar to an aircraft. Still very heavily aircraft influenced. Abort buttons, the center panel, fuel selection. Whatnot. A lot of configuration work in all of these things. Again, so part of the theme of this lecture is sort of all the ways that you begin to see these Apollo elements coming in, and simulation is certainly a big one. There were a number of Gemini simulators for different purposes. Obviously, the rendezvous and docking was an important part of it. And you start to see some of the more complex simulation technology coming in this case with a separate image generator kind of connected to the window. We'll see that with Apollo, too. Nobody's ever written a book on just the history of the simulators in Apollo. Somebody ought to, if anybody is looking for a good dissertation topic. It's a very rich topic. There's a lot of interesting links down the road for it. And Gemini was the beginning of it. There was this rendezvous and docking simulator where you actually just brought these two vehicles together. And you know, at this time, these simulators were really heavily based on sort of basic technology of very precise servos under computer control, not the kind of virtual world stuff that we think of today. But fairly effective there in some ways. Training in planetaria for star sighting. Interesting to me because my father was designing planetaria around the same time in the early 60s. Yep.
Say a word about the simulators. I think we'll come back to it in Apollo. They were, what Dave was describing, were called terrain boards, terrain models. It was actually a physical three-dimensional model, and then the TV camera would be servo-driven above it. There often was an absence of detailed knowledge of what it was you were supposed to be modeling. And as we'll see as we get into the Apollo mission, sometimes that led to getting lost on your way to the moon. The fact that as you would fly over certain features, they didn't look like what had been represented to them
I think it was Apollo 16, Dave Scott's mission, where they had a momentary disorientation, and it was traced back to the guy who built the Plaster of Paris model for the simulator had misinterpreted some of the photographs And along the lines of what Farouk Albaz was saying last week, you know, those photographs, you can extract a fair amount of quantitative elevation information out of them just by the intensity of the reflection and a little bit out of the shadows. And the guy had made a mistake doing that. And when Dave Scott came over, when they pitched up and he looked out, what he thought would be big craters were these very, very gentle sort of 1 meter high elevations.
My comment is not meant as a criticism, but you really have to give a lot of credit to the simulator development effort that went on. This really changed the whole world of out-the-window visuals, which of course led into both military and commercial use of flight simulations.
We'll see this in Apollo, but where they would build these dioramas, they put them upside down, and then there'd be a kind of mini gantry that actually held the camera. And when they did the lunar lander, the gantry would follow the trajectory with a little camera, to the point where if they crashed, sometimes the camera would literally bump into the terrain. And what's interesting about that, another good book to be written, is Apollo ends in 1972. First Star Wars movie comes out in 1977, 5 years later. I've already talked a little bit, I think. Did I talk about the climactic scene there? Well, I'll show it to you. What is the climactic scene in the first Star Wars movie? Okay, you blow up the Death Star. What happens? What's visually what's happening? He's flying through that trench on the kind of equator of the Death Star. Okay, how do you think that was created? Lots of precision servos under computer control with a camera on it focused on a little diorama. What's the climactic moment of that part, which is the heightened tension of the entire film? He turns off the targeting computer, right? Straight out of Apollo 11, right? I'll show you that scene. I have it when we look at the landings more closely. Propulsion. Well, I'm gonna skip through some of this because I want to talk a little bit more about the missions. This is an interesting one. Does anybody know? Is this how they landed? It is not how they landed, but it was dealt with seriously under development for a long time. The name of the wing is the Rogallo wing. Right? And it really was the kind of birth of the hang glider idea, and it went on to have a strong technological history, but just not in human spaceflight. But the idea was that if you wanted to reduce the cost, so you didn't need the entire U.S. Atlantic fleet out there fishing you out, and B, be able to land with precision, so you already see this sort of like, we hate coming down in the capsule under the parachute, we want to fly the thing to the ground. And this was not a fanciful idea. This was the program recovery mode, you know, for a good way into the program before it was canceled. Because of costs, I've always read, and I'm not exactly sure why, it turned out to be not viable. This, of course, was the way that it was done. Again, not a trivial system just to make that work. Interestingly, on Apollo, how many parachutes were there? Anybody know? Three, you know, which I'm not sure, but I suspect any one of them could have gotten you home safe, so triply redundant. Here, you've only got one. You really want to make sure it works. So somebody asked about the ejection seats. Very interesting. You know, it was tried here. Pretty scary. This is one model of the trajectory, because it's not even like an airplane, which if you were on the ground, there are zero ejection seats that you can survive if you launch from the ground in a stop. But those you go up, right? This one you went out the sides. The idea was, and I gotta say, I'm not remembering exactly why they reject the tower. It may have been a weight issue. It certainly complicated the design of the spacecraft internally quite a bit. And there was a, here's an image of what it might have looked like on a good day. And there was a case, I mean, they all knew this was a pretty scary thing, and I'll forget the actual number, but it was Gus Grissom, may have been Gemini 3 or something, where there was a, by the procedure, he should have aborted, and there was a problem with that. They sort of had, he got an indication he was supposed to, he got an indication the spacecraft had lifted off, which turned out to be erroneous. But he was sufficiently afraid of this that he said, you know what, I'm going to risk that this indication was wrong rather than, you know, you really only want to do this if you know you're going to die the other way. Big evolution in mission control. They move, all the Mercury flights are controlled from the Cape. The first two Gemini flights are controlled from the Cape, and then they move to Houston. It's just beginning to be ready. So again, as part of that experience buildup, not just the actual room itself, but all of that thinking about, you know, you start to see names like Chris Kraft controlling Gemini missions. Interestingly, the guy who was the sort of chief controller on the ground for the Mercury missions was Walter Williams, who had been the kind of overseer of the X-15 program. So there's very direct. Again, nobody's written a book on the history of mission control, which is interesting. But you can trace a lot of that, the techniques from the high range in the X-15 telemetry monitoring system through Walter Williams and a bunch of the guys from the high-speed flight station out at Edwards through Mercury and then in here.
One small editorial. If I
yeah,
might,
yeah, please.
It's a fascinating photo. IBM had mainframes in the portion of this building. Those monitor screens you see here make me laugh because we all have our tablets out or whatever right now. All that was on those monitor screens was a stream of numbers.
Yeah.
And if you were the thermal control system or the guidance system, they would put up a template that had holes cut out that would say your temperature is, and the little hole would be there, and the right number would show through. Okay? The printing, this is kind of cool. This is just cool history stuff. The printing was done via these things. You know what these things are?
Oh, air tubes.
They're pneumatic tubes. I want this printed. So, anyway.
Yeah, and you know, it's because everybody, including me, for years, you look at this image
or the successive Apollo images, and you think, wow, these guys are like typing commands in and controlling the whole thing. And there's all these flashing lights. But what are the flashing lights?
Indicators.
Sorry? Well, they're indicators, but a lot of it is also, they're just telephone connections. They, you know, it's like old-fashioned switchboard technology. You know, push your back room and you can talk to them. And you can see, if you look, you probably see each guy has a little dialer somewhere. In Apollo, there was one guy who had a copy of the disky who could issue commands to the computer. And there's obviously a range safety guy who can abort, and it's not that they had no control, but most of what they're doing is monitoring. And I think it's also very interesting because, you know, how much of the world today is a bunch of people sitting in front of computers, right? To begin with, you can go to the AT&T Network System Center or the Akamai Network Center. I'm sure Google has a room like this, so on and so forth. But even so many other places, this was really one of the first times that you'd see that configuration of people and kind of introduced it to people. A friend of mine who grew up in this era, who became an engineer, said, you know, they always used to show all this stuff and show the room. And I always wanted to know, what did all those guys do? And they never buttoned down and told you. Now we know and we'll tell you. And we've even had some of them in to talk to us. But you know, each one, again, think about the relationship we talked about between the structure of the system inside the vehicle and the structure of the social network on the ground that supports it. This is exactly a mirror of the systems on the vehicle, right? So there's one guy for environmental, there's one for guidance and control, there's one for propulsion, there's one for medical, and that's exactly the kind of maps out what's going on there.
Two other small comments about this. Mm-hmm. We were talking about the comm panels, the little lights. There's another parallel room to this. So they would have this room being active, the other one being worked on, and then the next launch would flip-flop. In between the flip-flops, they would hardwire the comm buttons to their right destinations pertaining to the mission. Today, we just use digital loops. We just say, I want to talk to this, and it goes off. That's one thing. The second thing, you see the orbital trace on the front wall there?
Mm-hmm.
There is a huge mirror off of which a projector bounces
and then backlights that screen, and for the orbital trees, someone actually moved a little icon, you know, like the Monopoly icon, and kept ever just updating it every now and then.
That's a good summary, huh.
This is actually the Houston room that's still there, right? And it was used for the first couple shuttle flights, I believe, and now it's a national landmark, so it's never going to be touched, and it's returned roughly to its Apollo state, I believe. I've been in there. Gilruth and George Lowe, I believe, and forgot my labels here. But again, and the Apollo 13 movie does such a great job about this is a kind of stage on which these dramas are played out, right? And again, if you've been there and or if you will pay attention in the films, back here is this huge viewing gallery. It's behind glass so people don't interfere, but you look at that viewing gallery for Apollo 11 or probably any of them, there's a lot of brass literally back there. Top military people, top politicians, maybe families of astronauts. Also a lot of smoking going on. That's a big difference from what you'd see today. Must have been a little bit awful to be in there. TJ just mentioned this, the RTCC, NASA's Real-Time Computer Complex, is sort of brought online during this period. Five linked 7094, sort of pretty famous in the history of computing, later IBM 360s, that's sort of mid-60s, comes out, also a very important computer during a period. Again, nobody's actually written too much about that part of it, but there are, for example, a number of the people who worked on that went on to found some of the key companies that do financial computing for Wall Street and whatnot. Not a small blip in the history of how do you manage large-scale, real-time computation units at the mainframe scale. I'm trying to remember who was, but I don't exactly. Again, also the introduction of the kind of more mobile real-time tracking network. We'll see this with Apollo even more so. All these sort of exotic different aircrafts, ships, and ground stations. And it's not, and you'll see very much as part, if you actually look at the transcripts of the missions, you know, who's getting which signal when is not a trivial part of managing the communications. And actually in Mercury, all those signals went through an AT&T switching network on the East Coast. It may have even been in Maryland. And there was somebody manually plugging in, you know, the different comms networks as the vehicle orbited the Earth. And they just had to keep up and kind of keep up. But there was a fairly small, finite number of them, and the missions weren't very long. I think already by Gemini that was a little bit more automated or a little bit easier. Anybody ever see the movie The Dish? It's a great movie, actually, and it's about the sort of folks in the tracking station in Canberra, Australia, and the role they played. And, you know, they're like out in the outback in Australia, but they end up having this, you know, it turned out that they were right on at the moment of the landing or the first getting out on Apollo 11, and took a lot of pride in that. And there is a good book on the tracking and networks. Some of the consoles for tracking. Also then, the Gemini introduces a digital flight computer. I mentioned this in the chapter of the book. Instead of having different programs, like we'll see in the Apollo computer, the crew just had paper tapes, and they would read the paper tapes in, and okay, we're going into the ascent phase, you know, get out the ascent tape, make sure not to rip it with your gloves on, you know, and read it in. And didn't actually, was not a digital controller in the sense that the Apollo computer became, and the Apollo computer wasn't originally conceived to do that either. It was more like a calculator. It could monitor things. It could actually monitor the launch vehicle on Titan. I don't believe it could take over and control the vehicle. Again, built by IBM in Oswego, New York. They're the people who ended up building the computer for the Saturn controller, which we haven't talked too much about yet. And there was actually a kind of palace coup moment during Apollo where people tried to bring them in and say, those guys at MIT are screwing up, get rid of them, let IBM build the Apollo computer. It used core memory and transistors. It was not technically a general purpose computer in the Turing sense. It was more specialized, custom thing than that. And there was only one, and it just was designed to be reliable, which is also an issue that we talked about before that comes up again. I believe this one is in the Air and Space Museum. There's an exhibit on flight computers, and I think this is the photograph of the Gemini one. What it did do was give you a calculation and say, and this again comes up in Apollo, you know, we want to do this burn from where we are, and we want to get into such and such orbit at such and such velocity. And it would say, okay, here are the angles you want to orient toward, and then here's the velocity to be gained. And then as you, the astronaut would joystick it, and then it would count down velocity remaining, IVI, the incremental velocity indicator. And when that got to zero, they knew they were there. Again, mentioned talking about the software. They called the math flows for these different modes, and very memory limited, and later on began to be a little bit flexible with regard to different rendezvous modes. But again, mostly in the calculation side. Now, am I wrong about this? So it did actually control the pointing. This is in the book, and I'm actually forgetting it. According to this diagram, it does actually give banks to the attitude control computers. It doesn't control the main engine, and does generate the display. So it's also an interesting one where the displays, you know, they look like analog displays. This is true in Apollo too. They're actually generated from the digital computer, which is actually kind of similar how it's done today. If you look at a commercial airliner, it has a digital PFD with, you know, any number of tens of megahertz running it. And what's it doing? It's recreating an analog display, because that's the best way for the human to get the flight data in. There was an inertial platform as well, and also radar inputs for the rendezvous. Another important early development that comes back on Apollo, very tricky thing, is the use of fuel cells instead of batteries. Very difficult on Apollo. In fact, they end up getting booted out of the lunar module in favor of batteries, which limited the power somewhat, but there were a lot of trouble developing them, but pretty commonly used today. Are there fuel cells on the station?
No fuel cells on the station.
But there are on the shuttle.
Two kilowatts each. Comms. A little bit of a shot, interesting story. It's in the chapter about the various levels of accuracy for each of the landings. Again, you know, you think about the system, you know, uploading coordinates. There was an error, I think that was on Grissom's flight, and there was a very long error in the landing area. But again, progressively learning, progressively bringing that window in. You know, it's interesting. On the one hand, precision is an engineering value. Like, engineering just like to do things precisely. If you're going to go at all, you might as well land precisely. But then there are all these other implications, like cost, safety, risk. There's good reason to do it. Although, I mean, that plays out in Apollo in an interesting way, because Apollo 11, we mentioned, is a few miles long. Apollo 12 focuses on real precision. By the time you get into the J missions and you have the rover, you know, you just kind of need to be nearby, and you just get in the car and you drive to the place you want to be. But you still want to, if you want to land in rough terrain. Innovations in the suits, what they called stand-up EVA, where they didn't actually go out, they just sort of stood there for a bit first. General mission profile. Um, 150 miles or so for 2 weeks. So there's a couple of unmanned missions at first, testing the launch vehicle. Again, not human rated when they started. Always running throughout all this. What does it mean to human rate a vehicle? That's still something NASA grapples with. There, you know, there was a great review panel, curious TJ on your perspective on this, where a couple of years ago it was published in Aerospace America, the AIAA magazine, and when the commercial crew contracts were first let, some people were saying they'll never be able to human rate those spacecraft, too expensive, too complicated, only NASA knows how to do it. And the contractors, SpaceX, and basically said, okay, tell us what your standards are. We'll design to those standards. And NASA sort of said, oh, wait a minute, we'll get back to you. And they went and said, what do we really mean by human rating? And in this conversation among a number of the people who were involved, they said, well, how did it work with the Russians? I mean, clearly you've done it with the Russians where, you know, you feel confident that their systems are human rated. And the response was, well, we went over there at first, this is the beginning of Shuttle Mir, and said, you know, here are standards, and oh my God, it's complete chaos over here. They're never going to meet our standards. And then we got to learn their systems, and we met their people, and we realized that they really had thought it through, and they were smart people, and we began to trust them. And you know, that's how eventually we learned how to work together. You know, that's a bit of an anecdote. It'd be interesting to read that sort of as a proper history, but always raised this question, kind of runs always through, what is human rating, right? What does it mean really on the ground? We talked about it last week. How much reliability? Well, 3 9s, okay. Maybe 4 9s, maybe 6 9s, who knows? A couple of the early Gemini flights are unmanned, which is interesting too. So they actually took a sequencer made out of telephone relays and stuck it in the pilot's seat and had it actuate the buttons in the proper sequence with some commands from the ground. So it was perfectly possible with the Gemini spacecraft to go up there, maneuver around, come down without a person there at all. This may be one of them. I think this is one of them. Gemini 2. Reentry protection, structural integrity, a whole bunch more. Again, thinking about the learning. What do you want to learn each time you go through? Interesting, too, to think about for the shuttle program. They didn't do any unmanned flights. The first flight ever had two people on it. Gemini 2, problems on the ground a little bit. Didn't really get off. Now I'm forgetting this one, actually. Yeah, it was a sort of hang fire. First manned flight, Gemini 3. Some basic experiments, but mostly evaluate the equipment. Again, really test flying, make sure the systems themselves work. Again, up on the curve of learning. This was the one where they had trouble loading they made a mistake with the landing coordinates, so it was quite long. 4 hours, about the length of a Mercury mission. And as you'll see here, you know, these names start to get real familiar from the Apollo point of view, right? Grissom, obviously, well, he was an Apollo astronaut, died in the fire. John Young only retired, what, a few years ago from NASA, flew on Apollo 16, and start to see things very similar. Early science experiments going up, weightless cells, visual acuity tests. Anybody know why this is important?
If you're going to dock something eventually, you better be able to see things.
Okay, docking matters, and actually also navigation.
Both for, on the Earth and on the Moon for Apollo, one of the key navigation modes was finding a known landmark, spotting it, and the computer would record the angle and the time that you saw it. And that was actually one of the more accurate ways to estimate position.
By this time, Dave, they were getting reports that astronauts in Mercury were seeing things which on the ground which probably they shouldn't have been able to see, like the Great Wall of China. So they wanted to try to get some real data.
I mean, this diagram here actually looks
a lot like any number of Apollo navigation calculations that look a lot like this. Like, what is the, in fact, it's interesting control problem to think about. Can we program the thing so it'll keep its orientation over a point on the ground as you go over it? Radiation on reentry, and why is that important? Sorry?
So you don't die.
So you don't die, but you also care a lot about comms.
What is the optimal placement of the antennas? Gemini 4, really interesting flight. This is the image that sort of came to be iconic. Big deal. It's the first US EVA, not the first EVA. The Russians had done it before. But as I mentioned, there's interesting because there's a not the best known part of Gemini 4 is when McDivitt tries to rendezvous with their spent booster and really isn't prepared for it and thinks he can tries to fly it like an airplane in a single plane and is really introduced to some of the mind-bending aspects of orbital navigation and how different it is from trying to fly an airplane. And it was actually Siemens who did the investigation of the problems with that. And they came up with, like, they knew this, obviously, but this was going to be a lot more challenging. And I think Rendezvous is an interesting case there because, the chapter I gave you to read was called Airmen in Space. And it's one of the real moments where they realize airmen can't do this, right? All of the skills that you're used to, you need other things. You need a completely different set of physics in your head, in a way, and you also need not necessarily a digital computer, because one of the really interesting ways to do Rendezvous is they call them nomograms. Anybody know what a nomogram is? Larry, I'm sure, does, but none of you may. It's a chart that's printed with a curve on it, but it's actually an analog computer, right? And it's a sort of very sophisticated piece of printed technology that allows you, you've probably seen them where the simplest ones that you still see sometimes is where you have Fahrenheit and Celsius down one side and you just kind of draw a line, or there's a line there, and it allows you to convert. But there were very, very sophisticated, very beautiful, we'll show you some of them, nomograms to allow you to do Rendezvous. And toward the end of the program, I think John Young in Gemini 8 or 9, or whichever one he flew with Buzz, they started to really do some sophisticated stuff where the idea was, if you really think it through and you calculate the heck out of it and you put that on paper in this curve, you'll be able to rendezvous just by eye and by hand. And we'll come to that. But this was a big deal. And again, Ed White also died in the Apollo 1 fire, so sort of the, yeah.
Well, I was going to ask,
so when they were preparing for the Gemini 4, had they simulated Rendezvous, or were they just going to kind of get up there and wing it and see what happens?
That's a good question. I
They may have simulated it in the kind of, I mean, there's rendezvous and there's docking, right? So you distinguish between those by rendezvous is bringing the two spacecraft from dissimilar orbits close enough and then docking. TJ, is there a formal definition of that today with the station?
When
it becomes one and not the other?
The vehicles will do the rendezvous up to 400 meters.
Okay.
And then at that point it becomes fairly linear. And the only reason why it becomes fairly linear is because it's on the right axis. It's not doing the curvilinear stuff.
Yeah. So
I think they had simulated the docking more than the rendezvous. But again, all part of the process of learning. This was not something. Rendezvous with a spent booster stage is not exactly something that costs you a lot of extra money, right? And you're not going to launch two rockets within a week of each other until you've made some tries at it. Those of you who are into space suits, I'm sure David could give us a better explanation of why this is important than I can. Also early uses of the little handheld maneuvering unit. I always liked this because when I was a kid, I got a G.I. Joe, and the spaceman G.I. Joe came with one of these. And I never really understood what it was, actually, but with a camera. Sorry?
I don't. It's probably worth something, isn't it?
Gemini 5 with Cooper and Conrad. 8 days now. Begin to do some rendezvous with this little radar target I'll show you in a second. Look at the fuel cells. Look at the radar. Problems with the fuel cells. And this was the one that had the 89-mile overshoot with the landing. So it wasn't a Grissom flight, it was a Cooper flight, where they just read up. They didn't read up. I think they could upload numbers from the ground directly into the computer, which is true in Apollo 2, and there was an error in those numbers on the ground. And so again, as you see constantly, like, the numbers pass through the people, and the people are part of the system, and there can be risks associated with that or benefits. Here's the image of that great display. I mean, it wasn't for decades before you could see a display of this size that was with anything under $1 million with that kind of brightness. And the amount of energy you had to pour into that mirror, you know, without burning it up was a lot. Another good view of the controllers, you can see the telephone dialing there. This is really just the switchboard network, and they're looking at alphanumeric characters on there. This was that radar evaluation pod, the sort of first rendezvous target that was spit out from the back of the spacecraft. And then they begin getting into the serious rendezvous with this Agena vehicle, which is really just a kind of placeholder vehicle in a way. It was an Air Force satellite that I think had all the instrumentation taken out of it. And you launch it, you can leave it up there for a while, figure out where it is, do this kind of chase launch, and then come up to it. That's what it looks like on launch pad and in flight. Has a docking adapter on it.
I think you're perhaps unintentionally minimizing the importance of the rendezvous and docking aspect of Agena.
Okay.
Because that was the sine qua non of it. We knew you could get people up for Mercury. We believed that we could keep them alive for two weeks. Mm-hmm. But we could not do LOR or any orbital rendezvous on the way to the moon unless we were absolutely sure that you could pull off this trip. So this was, I felt, the most important objective of the Gemini program.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, it was fundamental to LOR. And
I'm just saying the Agena vehicle wasn't much other than a kind of dummy to stand in for something else. And later they used a different vehicle. It has you can see the docking adapter here. It was actually plagued with problems or any number of troubles with the Agena vehicle.
Some sort of radar boom or more visual, that part there.
That is an antenna, and I'm forgetting why it's stuck out like that, and it may just be the to get the omnidirectional tracking or comms for it.
So Gemini 7, begins Did they get to the Agena here? I'm forgetting. It's been a while. 14-day mission. That was the big one for 7. 7 and 8 are the ones that are start to get interesting, right? Yes. So 7 goes on December 4th, 65. 6 and 7. 6A goes on the 16th. And comes up to meet Gemini 7. So, whoops.
What are those suits that they're wearing?
It is a different suit. I'll have to look that up. Yeah. I noticed that too, and I... it's a lightweight pressure suit. The idea, if you're going to do EVA, you want to be able to move around. Not a particular design that survived, but there may have been components to it that did. Again, we should ask Deva about that. So 7 and 6A, they called it, even though it came up later, meet up in space. And there's 2 human spacecraft together. And gives you these kind of pictures, which are, again, easy to take for granted, but we didn't have a lot of pictures of our spacecraft in space from the outside to that point. There's no picture like this of Mercury spacecraft. We don't have a picture of John Glenn's in space. The visuals mattered. Nice view of the computer service module. Gemini 8 is an interesting one, and I'll say a little bit about it, but Dave can say a lot more about it for a whole bunch of reasons. You can see the duration, not a particularly long one. They did successfully dock with the Agena, and when they did, they started to experience a very strange, funny kind of rolling phenomena. And you can just imagine the dynamics of those two vehicles together are complicated, to say the least. And they had so many problems with the Agena that their first reaction, and I believe it was in the procedures, is to say, this is a problem with that crazy Agena vehicle. Let's get out of here. And they immediately undocked. And that turned out to be a bad idea. Because what the problem turned out to be, they didn't know this, was a stuck thruster on the Gemini vehicle. And why is it a bad idea to undock in that case? Yeah, because your mass is so much lower all of a sudden, and then you really start to spin. And it was, they were in danger of blacking out from the spinning, trying to solve this thing, trying to counter it, not countering it doesn't work, and then just starting to pull circuit breakers and end up doing it was actually not a technical requirement, but a procedural requirement that if they had had that problem or if they had used their secondary thrust thing, they had to abort immediately. So they aborted, they landed in a different ocean than the one that they had planned, and they sat there. I think there's not a photograph of them sitting there for quite a number of hours before they were picked up, which was not a problem and was sort of in the plan, and they were fine. But it wasn't the way that it was done in a normal situation. And it's a very interesting case for a number of reasons. Not least of them is it's a major crisis in orbit. It's the first emergency aboard. Not something you want to have happen, but after it's happened, you start to say, gee, you know, we handled something. Like we're, you know, that which does not kill us makes us stronger. But a big part of the experience curve was to deal with these kind of off-nominal events. And a lot of people felt later that one of the reasons Armstrong was selected for the Apollo 11 mission was his kind of coolness under fire in this case. Yeah?
Since you can't like predict when an abort's going to happen, were they able to hit water no matter where they were in orbit?
I'm sure they were. You have a lot, but they had control over the abort. Right, so they weren't going to initiate the abort in a case unless they probably could have been in a very extreme emergency, but they weren't going to initiate that at a time that would bring them over land, right? So I think it was planned where they could say, okay, you know what, our procedures say we've got to abort. It's relatively unusual that you would need to get out of orbit right now, no questions asked, with no preparation, right? And I think if you looked at the timeline, you'd see that they waited an hour or they waited a half hour or something. I mean, the orbits were pretty quick. It wasn't all that long. And they did want to time it, but they didn't want to time it to wait for the next rev. Or it was a prepared abort area. It didn't have the same size of the fleet, but there were Navy ships there. They weren't completely out of the realm.
Cross range in a capsule, right? They can't. They're on their path. They're on their orbital path, and they can't deviate.
Yeah. They maybe could have a few hundred meters or something, or a few miles, but not much.
It's a lot of fuel to do that. I mean, you know the story. That's why the wings on the shuttle are so big, right? Because the Air Force demanded a big cross range in case you had to abort over enemy territory, and to actually fly the missions that the shuttle ended up flying, they could only have been, a third or a quarter the size. So Dave Scott, feel free to ask him about this mission. It's very interesting to talk about. Very short, none of the long duration stuff, but I think in retrospect it was considered an important part on the learning curve. We can handle an emergency and survive. There's another shot of the Agena. EVA system for Gemini 8 wasn't tried. Predecessor of, I forget, what was the one that was called on the shuttle that they tried? MMU. Gemini 9, Stafford, Cernan, again. Both end up being commanders of Apollo missions. Am I right about that? Yeah. And when you look at these in detail, once the first rendezvous is done with the Agena, there's a lot of interesting experimentation on the rendezvous side. What is the right way to do that? If you read Aldrin's thesis or any of the theory on it, you'll see there's any number of ways to do it. And the basic physics are sort of simple, although they're not that simple. But at the end of the day, that you have these issues like visibility. What if you miss on the first try? Do you get a second try? What is the computation power? When are the difficult maneuvers performed? And it's that sort of stuff that turns the thing from a theory into a practical technology. And on the later Gemini flights, they're really messing around with that, figuring out different way to do it, docking from a rendezvous from above. Right? Why is that important for Apollo?
Yeah, it's the emergency save where the command module and service module has to
come down and pick up the LEM and bring it out of a very low orbit. So again, a lot of Apollo thinking by this point, and that's a fairly detailed maneuver. I can't remember if that was actually done on the later missions, but it was definitely an abort mode where if the ascent stage or even the whole LEM got stuck somewhere, you could go fish it up. And so confidence there. This was the one where there was a docking adapter in there. I think he said this. It looks like an angry alligator. The shroud didn't separate. They couldn't get in there, and typical frustration, 10 with Young and Collins, a lot of other issues around the vehicle being checked out. Bending mode of the two vehicles, maneuvering the vehicles together. Moving the vehicles into a different orbit together. Again, familiar faces from Apollo. Almost a three-day mission. And by this point, I wrote about this in the chapter, there's a lot of subtlety involved in what they're doing with the the later missions. Maneuver Wydakt again, do some tethered vehicles together, do the reentry totally under automatic control, that's sort of novel. Anybody know what this is, by the way?
Yes.
Yeah, it's just dye to increase the visibility for the recovery crews.
I thought it was to keep the sharks away.
Really?
Really. I may be wrong.
Yeah. Look
it
up.
It is a dye. It may have a shark repellent in it, but yeah.
Shark repellent's usually a tablet that just kind of sits next to you.
Tethered experiments, interesting. Jeff Hoffman did a bunch of tethered experiments on his shuttle flights. Finally, again,
why are the later Gemini missions much shorter? I mean, they had a couple of 12, 14-day missions in there. Now we're doing 3-day missions.
I think it just wasn't the same
compulsion to demonstrate that long duration. I think when they did those long duration missions, I mean, that was the mission, right? You know, and that was an extreme feat of human endurance. If you look at the images of them when they come down, they're a little haggard. And I think that they felt to get the engineering objectives, they just wasn't necessary.
The feedback from the astronauts on the long duration missions was, I don't want to do that again.
There you go.
12, last one with Lovell and Aldrin. Again, if you look at the details, Aldrin starts, he's doing some pretty sort of virtuoso rendezvous stuff, where he's got these extremely simple nomograms, demonstrates he can do it, you know, with something he can stick in his pocket. And these are all valuable abort modes and failure modes for Apollo as well. And that's all stuff they had in their pocket, literally. If you look at the checklist packs they had, the whole last half of it was just from the lunar surface back into rendezvous with the CSM, all the different ways you might need to do that if you had different kinds of failures. So you've become now routine on orbital docking, okay? Absolutely fundamental to making LOR possible. One wonders what would happen if they weren't able to prove that. Lot of EVA and just 1,000 hours of experience of all the different things you want to do. Not to mention, you know, Mercury ends, it's still at least 5 years before you're going to even begin to fly a test flight in Apollo. Sound familiar to anyone? Gemini filled that gap by quite a bit. Enhanced the roles of the astronauts as sort of critical controllers of the landings, and not to mention a fair amount of just straight flown science experiments, some of it directly relevant for Apollo and others just beginnings of human spaceflight science. Any questions on Gemini, comments? There's a lot more to say. There's some really good books on Gemini, and the details are actually really interesting. I wanted to kind of get through it today, so we went pretty quickly, but.
A lot of the, I mean, I know it's useful for lunar orbit rendezvous too, but you know, they're launching multiple vehicles, docking them. I mean, it's an Earth orbit rendezvous scenario, obviously, but was there no interest at that point? You know, if you're launching a bunch of pieces into a high enough orbit, they're not going to fall out right away. It seems like those modules are large enough that you could think about, you know, a small space station or something like that as part of an extended Gemini program.
You know, you don't really see that
in the planning documents. I mean, it comes up with Apollo because that's what Skylab is, right?
Right.
There is this, let me just jump ahead. There is this MOL, which is an Air Force, I mean, it's almost exactly what you just described, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a parallel program in a lot of ways. In fact, no small number of the Apollo astronauts were Air Force people who had been chosen for this MOL and then gotten canceled out of it, and they folded them into Apollo. So this is probably the closest thing to that. But the Agena vehicle had so much difficulty and didn't even have anything inside it, and you don't see that as much. You do see you know, there was a, around this period, there was a secret Soviet military space station, and I'm forgetting the name of it, where they were actually collecting imagery and analyzing it in orbit because they didn't have a great way to, they didn't have a corona equivalent to get the images down right then. And I think that's partly what this MOL was supposed to prove out, but it didn't really survive through. We didn't say too much about Dinosaur, but it's actually really interesting too, just to sort of stick it in there. What does it look like? So sort of often talked about as a kind of shuttle predecessor, a hand-flown orbital vehicle launched on top of a Gemini. The chief test pilot for it was actually Neil Armstrong, and before he got selected into Apollo, and raised a whole lot of interesting issues, but didn't survive. Probably when you all name your multi-billion dollar government programs that you're going to run in 10 years, you might think of a more forward-looking name.
I was working on the Dinosaur project. I was an engineer at the instrumentation laboratory working for Draper at the time. This must have been in 1959 or 60. Working on the guidance system for it, and it got canceled. And I thought, you know, is this the way I want to go through life, working on a little piece of a servo amplifier on a program that's going to get canceled? Maybe I ought to find a profession where I have more control. And that, more than anything else, led me to a PhD in my academic career. So I'm very grateful.
That may be the greatest thing that came out of Professor Young's career, although I think a lot of people's careers came out of it, actually.
I'll bring you, I have a great film about it, which is really tells you a lot about the level of anxiety about the human control of these spacecraft at the time.
Did they actually launch any of these?
No.
But Armstrong did a whole bunch of
very interesting, it was supposed to be launched aboard a Titan with very large fins, and he did a whole bunch of interesting simulations, but with a real aircraft, of aborting without the escape tower from various points on the pad if you had if you needed to abort. First orbital rendezvous, that's maybe the biggest deal. 14-day endurance, first dockings, precision splashdown, and arguably is the moment we can compare this against the Soviet program that the U.S., both in flashy achievements but also just in kind of knowledge infrastructure and all the things that are required on the ground, begins to surpass the Soviets. And, you know, it's also very relevant for the later conversations we'll have about the computer and the landing, in that Apollo doesn't really get hardcore serious panic mode until the middle of 1966, when Gemini is ending. And that's when the alarm bells start going off at the instrumentation lab, and that's when people, when the organization as a whole and a lot of the top people can really turn their attention to what's going on. And one thing you see with the, in the interviews I've done, a lot of people at the time and even maybe afterwards felt like North American particularly, but the other contractors, there was no really systematic way to incorporate the lessons learned in Gemini into the Apollo designs. The crews themselves brought a lot and came back and came to the instrumentation lab and said, don't do it that way, put this there. But the organizations were not very good at incorporating a lot of this experience. Questions, comments on that? Yep.
On a number of the later flights, it mentioned that they conducted EVAs. What exactly were the astronauts doing on these EVAs? I'm assuming not just floating around for fun.
Well, a lot of it was kind of, you know,
what you might call human factors experimentation, like how much can you see? How fatigued are you? Can you climb back? I think there was a film change exercise where they would actually climb back. What kind of handholds do you need? Obviously, suit performance and just basic metabolic, quantifying the metabolic rates of different activities.
The big finding on the first one, I guess, was the
heat production was considerably larger than had been calculated, resulting in fogging of the visor. Mm-hmm. Then we go back to the Russian one. Was it Tikhov who couldn't get back in?
Yeah, I had that problem too. You know, you got to smoosh yourself back in.
Close the hatch. I think he needed help from the crew member to do that. Overall, I think the lesson was, gee, stuff's a lot, even the simple things are a lot harder to do. It's true underwater, too. And they weren't actually, not that I know of, performing other kinds of experiments or constructing things or that sort of stuff. I don't think they interacted with the Agena at all when they were docked. That was a little scary to them. But they were tethered. They experimented with the maneuvering unit. And I'm sure any amount of tweaking of the spacesuit and the parameters and settings for that. Okay. Yep.
So what was the status of the Houston Manned Space Flight Center? Like, did they have like the neutral buoyancy tank?
They did
all of that infrastructure.
The neutral buoyancy tank that's there now is quite new, right? It's within 10 years old, but
we had a. For the shuttle era, we took out the centrifuge in Houston and made it a big pool. It was called the Wet F, and I forget what the Wet F stood for, but it's basically the water facility. And then, because space station was going to be so much larger, we have this 40-foot by 100-foot by 350-feet pool. It's the world's largest.
Anybody ever been there? And, it's really impressive. It's like the biggest piece of blue water I've ever seen.
And we built it because we wanted to put all of the applicable portions of the space station there to do EVA practices. So we actually tore down the Wet F. But prior to the Wet F, I don't know that we had any.
There's one in Huntsville.
There was one in Huntsville, you're right.
Yeah. That I think was pretty regularly used until the new one. The one that's there now is 10 years old, maybe?
Well, at least 14.
Okay.
One
that
still came in during the shuttle program.
Okay. I think it was also, you don't see a lot about underwater training in Apollo.
There was maybe some, but very experimental and limited. I mean, also requires a lot of infrastructure and a lot of learning. It's a whole technology into itself.
You've heard three thoughts, if I can just take 22 seconds, promise. Anybody seen the HBO series From Earth to Moon? In this course, I think you'd find it just fascinating.
Yeah, we watch clips of it from time to time.
It's wonderful. The second thing, Leonov was the Russian who did the first EVA. I've actually had the pleasure of sitting next to Leonov. And he was telling a group of us sitting around him that he was really worried about coming back in because he Stay Puft Marshmallow Man too much and couldn't get back in. And he didn't think he was coming home. Until they told him to depress his suit. You want me to do what? So he actually undid the little relief valve and fit back in. What really irked the entire community, of course, is that the Russians knew we had a problem. And we still let it white go because they never told us. And then we had similar things. And then the third thing I'll leave you with, leave him laughing, right? It's the rule. John Young, we talked about here. Even after he retired, would come back to the Monday morning meetings that the astronaut office would have and participate, a big safety proponent individual. When he was still active as an astronaut and management an astronaut, he was still attending the Monday morning meetings as well. And you might imagine that in the astronaut community there are a lot of A-type personalities. One of the more flown shuttle commanders, who had an extremely aggressive personality, got into a debate one Monday morning meeting. And finally said, you know, I have got as many launches as John Young. Why don't you take my opinion? And John Young said, how many launches you got? And he said, six. I said, I've got seven. The guy said, no, you got two Gemini, you got two Apollo, you got two shuttle. He goes, in his best Southern Texas draw, John Young goes, do you count the one from the moon?
Young was the only person to fly Gemini, Apollo, and shuttle. He commanded the first shuttle mission, which is an interesting mission in and of itself. And that, I mean, it's a great story, and it points to a really important thing. We've seen, and we'll see more of, all the things it took to get even a Titan, much less the Saturn, ready to go on the in Florida at a NASA facility with all of the support and all of the networks. And no small amount of the concern about the Apollo program is, okay, now you're on the moon, you have two guys that got to prepare the vehicle to launch by themselves, you know, under pressure, you know, fatigued, without all that kind of help. And it was very much a launch. The interesting thing about the LEM, you think about it, it's just a multi-stage rocket, except for, unlike the ones from the Earth, the flight down comes first and the flight up goes second. okay. Any other questions, comments on Gemini?
It came up. When they first started flying shuttle, did they have ejection seats on board for
shuttle? They did, yeah, the first few.
Okay. I think as many as four people,
right,
but not seven.
Other tech problems. Yeah. I mean, it only saves you for a pretty brief period, if you have that. And
you know, that first shuttle flight with Young and Crippen is a pretty nervy thing to do. You know, actually the transcripts for that all exist, and somebody ought to write a good book about what was involved and what was learned. And
One comment on it. We had a professor, the visiting professor some years ago was Dwayne McCrewer, and he was on the shuttle safety review, readiness review prior to STS-1. And they were going through the equipment that on board, and in it was a rather large box. And when the inquiries made about what it was, they said, well, this is the box which will withstand re-entry. Should the shuttle come apart on orbit, it contains the flight recording system, so we can recover the instrumentation. And John Young, sitting there as the commander of the first shuttle flight, said, can I fit into it?